Very good morning, dear friends. Myself, Dr. Vikrant Sudhakar Paikar. I am working as assistant professor in Gokhale Education Society's Arts, Commerce and Science College, Jawahar Palghar. Welcome in the lecture series on the topic synthesis of organic compounds. This is the third session we are doing. In earlier sessions, we have tried to understand what is ideal organic synthesis, what are the different organic synthesis, that is linear synthesis and convergent synthesis. And in the last session, we have seen what is multi-component reactions. And we have understood in which more than two components react in a one single vessel to form a product. So that particular reactions are more advantageous as a point of view of overall yield and atom economy. So in the multi-component series, we are going to see the second reaction. First reaction we have seen is the Mannich reactions, and where we have understood that beta amino compounds are formed as a product. Then in this session we are going to see what is Bignelli reaction. So basically Bignelli reaction is a multi-component reaction which occurs in a one pot where three components react together. First one is beta keto ester, then aryl halide and urea, and they formed pyrimidone derivatives under acidic conditions. So these reactions are also catalyzed by using Bronsted acids and Lewis acid. So basically these three components react in a single vessel, we have understood. So let us see what are these three components. First, what I have told you is the beta keto ester. So beta keto ester is the, let us say, ethyl acetoacetate. As we know that ethyl acetoacetate is an active methylene compound, where CH2 is flanked in between the two carbonyl compounds. So this is a 1,3 dicarbonyl compound. So basically it undergo tautomerization and it get converted from keto form into enol form, where we can see one of the carbonyl get converted into OH. So it is being more stable form. So this is a beta keto ester in the tautomer form. Then second one is the aryl halide. So let us say aryl halide may be either benzaldehyde, or you can take any one of the aromatic halide. So this is the aryl halide. And third one is the urea. So what is the structure of urea? NH2 C double bond O NH2. So these three components react in a single vessel, and they undergo in the acidic condition with removal of water to form pyrimidone's derivative. So let us see the reaction. So in the first step, enol. So this is structure of enol we have written. This is a CH3 COH double bond CH C double bond O OC2H5. Then it will react with the benzaldehyde. I have written it purposely in the inverted form. And third component is the urea. So written the protons separately, which are attached to the nitrogen. So it is a NH2 C double bond O NH2. So these three components under acidic conditions reacts to dehydration reactions, where two molecules of water is being removed. So let us see how these two molecules is being removed. So first molecule is removed by one of the proton from enol, then oxygen from benzaldehyde, and another proton from urea of one of the nitrogen. While second molecule of water is being removed in this way, which I have shown in the red marks. So OH and H from here. So these two molecules are being removed from these three components, and under acidic conditions, you will get formation of pyrimidones. So these are the derivatives which are called as a pyrimidones. So basically dihydropyrimidones are the cyclic compounds. So let us see what is the structures which are obtained from these three components. So if we clearly see this particular part, which is obtained from enol, then if you see, this particular part which is coming from the urea, and this part is coming from the aryl halide. So this is the basically dihydropyrimidones form in this way. See, go through the structure. So here you can clearly see this is the part which is coming from the urea. When you draw the structure, make sure of the valences. Okay, so remember Bignell reactions results into the formation of dihydropyrimidone. So basically if you see, this dihydropyrimidones are considered as one of the very important chemical entity in terms of the pharmaceutical utility. They are having a lot of therapeutic activities, such as they are used as antihypertensive agent, calcium channel blockers, and alpha antagonists. So these Bignell reactions, if you see the history, it is being invented in the 1893. So later on, there are lot number of modifications have done in the Bignell reactions, where people have used different derivative in terms of urea. Thiourea also you can use, or different substituted thiourea also you can use. Then instead of aryl halides, you can go for different combination of aldehydes. So basically if you see the Bignell reactions, this dihydropyrimidones as one of the important pharmaceutical molecules, so they are having a lot of importance. So this is a Bignell reaction what we have seen. Remember, go through these reactions and try to write the structures so that we can come to the final product. Now we are going to see the very important topic in the this particular topic is green chemistry. As this particular green chemistry nowadays is very important as a point of view that a lot of environmental issues arises when any particular organic synthesis is being carried out. So what is the problem with the organic synthesis is that along with the formation of the important product, there are a lot number of byproducts are being formed, and many times these byproducts are thrown inside the environment and they are creating n number of issues. So in order to have a very good ideal synthesis, the green chemistry principles must be followed. So let us see what is green chemistry. So basically it is defined as utilization of set of principles where you can have the different principles that reduces or eliminates the use of generation of hazardous substances in the design of chemical products. So basically in green chemistry, your aim should be that you should design organic synthesis in a such a way that it will reduce or eliminate generation of hazardous waste material which are formed inside the reactions. So basically the design of chemical products that will more be environmentally benign and reduce negative impact to human health and environment. So the organic synthesis must be carried out that will take care of the environmental issues and also that will not have the negative impact on human health and environment. So this must be taken into consideration. So in order to carry out the green synthesis, we must use renewable raw materials, that is green materials. Then solvents must be green in terms of they should not have the hazardous issue. Then catalyst, you go for the catalyst, and basically catalytic reagents, so that will help you in order to have the efficient process, and that will be of course environment benign. So these things must be taken into the consideration. Now in order to have the green chemistry perspective, we must follow the principles of green chemistry. So there are 12 principles of green chemistry. If you follow these 12 principles, then that particular synthesis will be called as a green synthesis. So let us see one by one principles. These principles are very important. Let us see first one. First is the prevention of waste. Whatever the waste that is byproduct form, you must prevent its formation. Then your ideal synthesis must be in such a way that maximum atoms must be incorporated inside the product. So that particular process will be most atom economical. Use of safe chemicals. use of safe solvent is also one of the important criteria while green chemistry synthesis you have to carry out. Then synthesis of safe products, safe in terms of hazardous issue. Use of energy efficiency, go for the renewable energy resources. Then use renewable feedstock, the raw materials what we are using, that must be renewable. During synthesis, avoid derivatization, that is protection, deprotection, these are the concepts. Then use catalyst instead of reagents. So use the catalytic reagent, this is a very good option for this particular point. Then go for the biodegradable chemicals. Your chemicals, whatever you are using, that must be degraded inside the environment very smoothly. Then one of the important aspect, while reaction, monitor the process of simultaneously while conducting them. While performing organic synthesis, you should monitor the reaction. What is the we can say conversion ratio, what are the byproducts which are you should monitor the process. Then very important aspect in terms of health and other issues, that is minimum potential of accidents. Your organic synthesis must take care of all the safety aspects. So we will see all these green chemistry principles. If you follow these all 12 principles, then that particular synthesis will be called as a green synthesis. So go through these 12 principles, we will see one by one what is its important. So first one, as we know that there is a one term, prevention is better than cure. So you should prevent before that thing is going to happen. So prevention of waste, this is a very, very important criteria. So it is always better to prevent waste formation rather than to treat or clean up waste after it is formed. So this particular byproduct formation aspect you must take care before you design that particular organic synthesis on paper or when you carry out the synthesis process. So that particular aspect must be taken care of. Then second principle, synthetic methods should be designed to maximize the incorporation of all materials used in the process into final products. That I already told you. So as we know that many reactions are there that will not give 100% yield. So what will happen? They produce a large amount of byproducts. So they will come into the formation of various waste product or hazardous waste, we can say. So that particular synthesis will not be green. So in order to have a green synthesis, you should take into the consideration of atom economy. So for example, such a reaction, such as addition of Grignard reagent to aldehyde and ketone. So that generates the byproduct, that is MgOHX. Let us go to the reaction. As we know that whenever Grignard reagent get added to the carbonyl compound, that forms the addition product. And this addition product, which on hydrolysis, gives the formation of this particular byproduct. As we know that MgOHX, it is a hazardous compound. Magnesium, when it got thrown inside the environment, it may create a lot of health issue to aquatic animals also and living organism also. So this type of synthesis must be avoided. Then let us say third one. Wherever practicable, synthetic methodology should be designed to use the and generate substances that possess little or no toxicity to human health and environment. So methodology should be designed that should not generate a chemical substances that will have toxic effect to human health and environment. So this particular thing must be taken into the consideration. Then fourth one, the chemical product should be designed to preserve efficacy of function while reducing toxicity. You should preserve the efficacy of the reaction. So this is very important criteria when we go for the organic synthesis. Then use of auxiliary substances such as solvents or separating agent should be avoided. So whenever it is now practically possible to avoid such a substances, you should go for it. Solvents must be very green. You should not go for chlorinated solvents. Go for the solvents which are having green perspective. Then in order to carry the reaction, we need energy. So energy requirement should be recognized for the environmental and economic impact should be minimized. So we should go for renewable energy sources, such as if it is possible, go for the microwaves. For solvents, you go for supercritical carbon dioxide. So such aspects must be considered. So energy requirement, this criteria must be taken care of. Then seventh one, raw material or feedstock should be renewable rather than depleting whenever technically and economically practical. So whatever raw material we are going to use, that must be renewable. That should not happen if you use more raw material which are not renewable. So ultimately that is going to affect on economical things. Unnecessary derivatization. So many times in the organic synthesis should not be designed in such a way that in the first step you carry protection, then you carry out some reaction, then again you carry out deprotection. So in that case, what will happen? The yield will get reduced, then other synthetic operations will get increased. So automatically it will affect on your yield also and economic impact also. So such things must be avoided. Then catalytic reagents. Go for the catalytic reagents. The reagents which are having catalytic activity must be preferred because they are superior as compared to the stoichiometric reagent. But many times what we do, we take the substrate, we take the reagent, and we then again add to a catalyst. So it will, if you go for catalytic reagents, then it will help a lot. Then chemical products would be designed so that at the end of their functional, they do not persist in the environment and release toxic degradation and produce products into soil and atmosphere. So chemical products, whatever you are going to use in organic synthesis, that must be degradable. They should not persist inside the environment. If they do persist, they will have a lot of toxic effect. They will decrease the soil fertility, and they will also affect the atmosphere. So they are not environment friendly. So go for the degradable chemical products. 11. Analytical methodology need to be further developed to allow for real-time in-process monitoring and control prior to the formation of hazardous substances. So what is this particular point? When you carry out any particular organic synthesis, you must do all the time real-time analysis. So if you find out that any particular byproduct is forming in your reaction, you must identify and think for the solution which will not form such a byproducts or hazardous substances. So that is very beneficial in terms of yield and another hazard issue. So go for real-time in-process monitoring. And last principle, substances and the form of substances used in chemical process should be chosen so as to minimize the potential of chemical accidents, including release of explosions and fires. So this is a safety issue. So chemical accidents, explosions, fire, that should be taken care of while designing organic synthesis. So in order to have the very good ideal synthesis, you must follow green chemistry perspective. In terms of nowadays, it is being very important to take care of all green chemistry principles in while doing the organic synthesis. So these are the 12 principles. If you follow this 12 principle, definitely the whatever the synthesis you are being carrying out, it will be a green synthesis. So go through this 12 principle. Definitely you will understand that the green chemistry part is very important in terms of having a very good chemical synthesis. Thank you very much. Go through it.